Dr. Leslie Williams, and I'd like to welcome you to Biology of Marine Mammals. In this course, we use the study of marine mammals as framework to explore major biological principles that actually apply to all living organisms. Now, the study of biology is extremely diverse, ranging from the study of macromolecules and how they move inside our tiny, tiny cells, all the way to the study of whole communities and ecosystems, such as those found in Yellowstone National Park. But here, we will focus on mammals, and more specifically, marine mammals, as a template for studying some of these major biological principles. After a proper introduction to marine mammals, we'll then spend the first third of the course learning about the theories of natural selection and evolution and how to apply these principles as we explore marine mammal evolution and diversity. Next, we move on to the fascinating branch of anatomy and physiology, which is actually the study of body form and function. Here, we'll explore the body structure and function of whales and dolphins, seals and sea lions, and even the sea otters to demonstrate how a marine mammal's body has adapted to live in these marine environments. Of course, all organisms interact with their environments, so we will study the interactions between selected marine mammals, such as northern elephant seals and sea otters, and their environments to explore biological topics such as ecology, behavior, and even human conservation. It is my hope that through the study of these mysterious yet awe-inspiring marine mammals, you will have advanced your general understanding of the processes that govern all living organisms, thus enhancing your role as an educated citizen. So without further ado, let's begin our first lecture, which simply addresses this question: what are marine mammals? Okay, in order to address what are marine mammals, we first need to actually take a look at animals in general and then talk about which properties define mammals. And from there, we'll take a look at what defines a marine mammal. So let's get started. All right, let's start with the animals. When we think of animals, it's convenient to actually break them down into two basic groups. We'll say the invertebrates, which include animals such as worms and insects and even things like sea urchins and sea stars. And then we have the vertebrates. Now, to be called a vertebrate, you have to actually satisfy two criteria. One is the presence of a cranial case. So when we have a cranial case, that simply means you have a skull or something like that that protects a brain. And then the other one, which is more commonly known, is that you have to have a backbone. So some type of rigid bone that basically goes through your back. It's not always made of bone, but something like that, that gives you support for your back. So vertebrates themselves are a very, very diverse group. And we go from fish to amphibians to reptiles, birds, and of course, mammals. So mammals are included in the study of vertebrates. So let's take a look at what are mammals. So when we think of all the different mammals, mammals tend to share these characteristics. Now it's important to understand that I'm saying share. It doesn't mean that they're defined by these characteristics or that other animals lack some of these, but rather when we look at all the mammals as a whole, we tend to see these trends. First, that they tend to give live birth. There are actually two exceptions to this, one being the duck-billed platypus, but as a general rule, they give live birth. And of course, humans being mammals, we recognize this. When we give birth to a living baby. We don't, let's say, lay an egg. So that's what's meant by giving live birth. Another is that parental care tends to be extensive. And of course, there's no more extensive parental care than when we look at humans, which of course are mammals. That is, we raise our young for an extended period of time, feeding them, nourishing them, providing behavioral guidance. And so, of course, for humans, we see that is marked extensively. But if we compare that to other animals like insects, they simply lay their eggs and most of the time the parents leave and the newborns are left to fend for themselves. So that is a feature of being a mammal. And of course, mammals are classified as being warm-blooded. Now, that actually takes a little bit of explanation. What does being warm-blooded mean? Well, yes, your blood is warm, but more specifically, it means that you use metabolism to generate your own heat. You are not strictly relying on the environment to warm you up. That's in sharp contrast to many reptiles that are considered to be cold-blooded. They often will try to go to a warm area, sun themselves, for example, so that they get the infrared radiation from the sun to help warm up their bodies. We, as mammals, don't need that. We tend to maintain a pretty consistent temperature simply by using the energy we generate from metabolism and movement. So that makes us warm-blooded. And finally, mammals, of course, tend to be intelligent. So now that we've talked about some of the characteristics that mammals share, let's actually define them. All mammals are differentiated from other vertebrates by two major properties. One is the presence of hair. And of course, simply go to your own body and you will know that you have hair on your body. So of course, mammals have hair. Humans tend to have less hair than many other mammals, such as dogs and cats. And many marine mammals, such as whales and dolphins, you may think, I've never seen a hair on them, but they actually do have them, although there's not very many. So all marine mammals have hair, even if it's just a few sprouts of it. And then, of course, all marine mammals have, or at least all the females do, have mammary glands that produce milk for their young. So those are two properties that actually define being a mammal. All right, so now let's take a look at who are our marine mammals. When you tend to think in your head about marine mammals, you probably think of whales and dolphins and seals and sea lions and maybe even sea otters. Those might be what you call the usual suspects. And what I mean by that are going to be mammals that live in the marine environment. And you recognize them as, hey, these are mammals that live in the ocean. To be marine means to be oceanic. So these are mammals that we find in the ocean. Whales, dolphins, seals, sea lions, even sea otters. But that's not the best definition of marine mammals. From a biological standpoint, because there are actually some exceptions or oddities to that rule. So yes, marine mammals are going to be mammals that live in the sea, but we're going to include a few extras in there as well, such as river dolphins. We have landlocked seals, so these are seals that are actually found in big lakes. They're not found in the ocean, and then the polar bear. So I'm going to briefly tell you about why each one of those groups is still encompassed in marine mammals. So when we take a look at the river dolphins, it turns out, yes, the river dolphins don't live in the ocean per se. They live in rivers, which tend to be more freshwater, but the river dolphins are evolutionarily related to all the other marine dolphins. So rather than say they're their own branch of science, we just group them in and say, yeah, they live in the river, but it's okay, we'll still include them in the study of marine mammals because of their evolutionary relationship to all the other dolphins. And that also applies to any seals that are considered to be landlocked. In other words, they live in a lake and they can't get to the ocean. Because they evolved from oceanic seals, we still include them in our study. Now, the polar bears are really interesting because the polar bears actually spend quite a bit of their time on land or even on sea ice. In fact, I wouldn't say they spend the majority of their time in water. In fact, they're rather poor swimmers and can actually drown in the marine environment. So why on earth do we study them as we study marine mammals? And the technicality lies in the fact that polar bears spend a lot of their time, or can spend a lot of their time, on sea ice, which essentially is ice that has frozen from the sea. So when we look at sea ice, we still consider it to be part of the marine environment. So for that reason, polar bears are also included in the study of marine mammals. And so now that you have a flavor for what defines mammals, what defines marine mammals, we are ready to get started with this class, and I will see you next time.